sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is a Tuesday edition of a Best of the Steve Jones Show all this week. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve is off this week on a well-deserved vacation. But other than that, he's always in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, a great selection of pre-owned inventory if that's where the budget says that's the route you need to take. A service department that is there for your current vehicle with the diagnostics, with the inspections, with the routine maintenance, and a sales staff that's not just there for the sale but is there for you. All part of the Sunbury Motors guarantee. All at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. So we're going with our themes during each day this week as we go through our best of shows while Steve enjoys his much-deserved vacation. Today it's all about Philly sports and also a little bit of horse racing mixed in as well. So today we have Alaa Abdulnaby, the NBC Sports Philly Sixers TV analyst, that will join us next, recapping the Sixers season when it ended in Game 6 against the Miami Heat in the Eastern Conference semis. Then at 3:35 today, we'll replay Ray Diddinger, the now retired Hall of Famer, who came on the show to promote his play Tommy and Me that he wrote based on a true story with his relationship with former Eagles receiver Tommy McDonald. It's really just a really remarkable story. I'm actually going to go down to see that when it comes to Hershey in August. I look forward to that. So we'll replay that at 3:35 today. Then NBC Sports Philly's Michael Barkan at 4:06 just joined us a couple of weeks ago. We'll replay that. And then in the final half hour, it's recapping another historic Kentucky Derby when Rich Strike was the winner as an 80-1 favorite. And Fox Sports horse racing reporter Lafitte Pinkai joined us to recap that historic race, and he will replay that interview coming up in the final half hour of the show. But coming up next, we'll start our Philly sports theme show with Sixers TV analyst Alaa Abdulnaby as we continue here on a Best of the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. It is a Best of the Steve Jones Show here on this Tuesday. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve, on vacation this week, but always in the Sunbury Motors studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Continuing our Best of today, it's all about Philly sports with a little horse racing in the final half hour. We'll kick things off with NBC Sports Philly Sixers TV analyst Alaa Abdulnaby, who joined us shortly following the Sixers season, which was another loss in the Eastern Conference semifinals to the Miami Heat.
Joined now by the outstanding Alaa Abdulnaby, who joins us to talk about the Sixers and the NBA playoffs. Alaa, welcome. It's great to have you with us.
Good to be with you, Steve. Thanks for having me on.
Okay. As you watched it play out, can you give us an idea, as someone who knows this, has played it, the kind of guts that Joel Embiid played with as we watched him during the course of the playoffs, and especially after he got hurt so badly in the thumb and in the face?
Well, I think he's come a long way, hasn't he, from a guy who, when he first got into the league, people wondered whether he was going to amount to anything, whether or not he was worthy of such a high pick. You know, that navicular bone that he had in his foot that he had to deal with for 2 years, you know, had a lot of doubters around. So when you ask that question, that's what makes me think of his journey. And to see him now and where he's come, not only a guy who plays practically night in and night out, but last year had the best year. It just speaks to his drive. It just speaks to his desire, his hunger. I think he sees a lot of his friends around him in the league who have celebrated and have been champions, and I think he wants a piece of that. I think he wants to be considered great, and I think he wants to leave a legacy. And, you know, he realizes that he doesn't want to be on that side of guys who never won but were great. He wants to be a guy who was great and also won. And I thought you saw all of his desire on full display, especially in the playoffs. Nobody is healthy or fully healthy come playoff time. But he was certainly carrying a bunch of stuff that other guys weren't. And like I said, I was impressed. And to be able to, you know, finish off Toronto up there in a tough scenario and then to come back and then have to deal with the facial situation just compounded things. But I don't think there's any doubt in how bad he is and how bad he wants it.
All right, so let me ask you this. Is there a concern on your part that's around this all the time that years are slipping away from surrounding a transcendent talent without making deeper runs?
Well, I think everybody's aware of the window, right? That proverbial window of opportunity that he's operating under, that the Sixers are operating under and are very well aware of. The trick is to put pieces around him, right? And James Harden was an experiment. I think it's an experiment that's still ongoing. And Tobias Harris has played probably his best, most clutch basketball. He was really good throughout the playoffs. Tyrese Maxey is coming into his own. So there are some pieces there, but I think everyone watching realizes that there's still a few pieces away. Would love to see some more athleticism and length in as far as the 3-4 position is concerned. But, you know, they're not that far away. They just need a few other pieces around Joel. But what a great place to start when you have the big fella.
All right, so let's get to the Harden part. I mean, they acquire him, and they had time to integrate him, and he had time to adjust to the Sixers' style. What worked and what didn't work as you watched it on an everyday basis?
Well, with all due respect, I'm not sure he did have enough time to adjust. You know, I kind of equate it to a quarterback being traded during the regular season in the NFL. You don't see it, because it's really hard to change a floor leader out there in midstream and then have to pick up the terminology on both ends of the floor. You're the head of the defense on one end, and then you're the leader on the offensive end of the floor. That's a lot. And then we don't know how healthy he's been, you know, in a Sixer uniform, because we knew when he left Brooklyn that he was kind of harboring a groin. And I can speak to you, you know, not personally, but with guys that I've played with that have had that issue, it doesn't just go away. Those are kind of things. Ask Devin Booker. You know, he was dealing with one as well. And, you know, it kind of reared its ugly head a couple of weeks ago for him. So, again, I'm not sure he was 100%. I would love to see him at 100% and the benefit of starting a training camp. Then I think we could fairly judge him. I know it's easy for us to label him, you know, as a guy who fell short because the Sixers fell short. But I'm not quite sure he was at full strength, so it's hard to judge a guy like that.
So what do you think of his game? How do you think he actually should be integrated?
Well, I think he's still a heck of a passer. You know, and he was all the way up until the end. I just don't know if that explosiveness is still there. But again, I go back to the groin, because if your groin is bothering you, you can't be as explosive. And his game was to get by the first guy covering him and then create advantages offensively. You didn't see that, especially against Miami. Now, give credit to Miami, because I'm watching them play the way they did last night against the Celtics. Miami's defense is really, really good. So it wasn't one-on-one. It was more one-on-three. And I don't know if anybody, not just James Harden, can get through three defenders each time down the floor. So, again, a tough thing to judge, because they were going up against a really good Miami defense that smothered him. He saw bodies when he crossed half court. There weren't a lot of places for him to go. But, again, shooting is also involved with your legs. And if your groin is kind of off, you're not balanced. So there's a lot of things that I'm willing to give him the benefit of the doubt for right now. But again, like I said, if you have a whole season underneath your belt and preseason camp and you're presumed healthy, then I think we start to judge you.
Right, exactly. Look, everything's tight this time of the year. Is this a question of missing a couple plays in the first half of a game, maybe a couple plays in the second half, and that's why it's not happening because the margin is so thin at this point?
Well, I think part of it, too, is how you close out quarters and halves. I think that's a big part of it, too, because you want to be heading into the locker room with momentum. And the 76ers, I don't think they did a really good job against the Miami Heat of closing out third quarters, because you never felt really good about their chances going into the fourth. So you could also say about their games down in Miami, the second quarter, finishing the second quarter, with the exception of maybe game one. So I think it's how you play, and like you said, it's such a small margin of error. Every possession counts. I think when you fall short, everything becomes magnified. But again, I repeat, I don't think the Sixers are that far off. I just think you need some athleticism and some more threes. The old 3 and D is what they call them. I'd like to see a few more of those characters out on the floor.
Yeah, no, exactly. All right, Celtics played last night without Smart. Horford hung in for a while. Jimmy Butler at 17. Heat won. Got Warriors. They're going to be in action. And they're not going to face the Suns. They're going to face Doncic and the Mavs. Let's take each series. I mean, you saw all four teams. I mean, what do you think of Heat and Celtics?
Well, I think it's going to be physical. And I think last night was a good example of that. And you heard Ime Udoka after the game talking about how his team has to adjust to that, because there's a lot at stake. The games are big games now. There's a lot to play for, is my point. And if it gets physical, you can't back down from that. You've got to match that. You've got to be able to play through that. And I think that's where Ime noticed last night, that they got punched in the mouth a little bit from Miami. Give them credit. And the Celtics, if they want to hang in this, have got to respond to it.
All right, so then you've got Dallas and the Warriors. Dallas went in to Phoenix, and that's one of the worst Game 7 home performances I've ever seen by a team. Hey, ever, in anything. anything. So, why? Why did that happen?
Well, I can just tell you that Phoenix didn't make adjustments. You know, they were taking the ball out of Chris Paul's hands early, as soon as he crossed half court a lot of times, and made other people start the offense, and it kind of threw them off. And I'm just surprised that they didn't make the adjustments necessary for them to overcome that. That and Luka was just on fire. Not only was he making huge buckets for them, but he was also getting other guys involved, and other guys stepped up, whether it was Brunson certain nights, Dinwiddie more recently. They've got some pieces there. I still think the Warriors are too much for them, but that doesn't mean it's not going to be fun to watch, because I think Luka on the other end at least gives Dallas a fighting chance each and every time down the floor.
I felt, and I said this after Game 4, which was in Dallas, I said, Dallas, Chris Paul will try to play bully ball with you at times. That's a compliment. That's not meant to be a cut. I said, Dallas is playing bully ball with him. And you and I know that sometimes guys that play that way don't like it when they're played with on that end of the floor. Did you see that? I felt like Dallas like physically went at him when he was playing defense.
I think, well, especially when they'd switch up and they'd have him on Luka. Luka's a big boy. Luka's a good 6'7". And even in that series, you saw him post up 8. So I don't think he was afraid to post up anybody on that Phoenix team. And he's just so gifted. He's so talented. And he's such a good passer that if he does draw double teams, he makes you pay for him. If not, he's able to shoot over him. And, yeah, your point is well taken, in that if you want a guy who is not going to be so vigorous on the offensive end, maybe make him defend on the defensive end and take his legs out. He's not going to be attacking you with the same kind of vigor. But I completely thought that they occupied Chris on the defensive end, and it may have taken something out of him. He is 37 after all.
Jeez. That didn't make me feel good.
Oh, I'm 53. He's much younger than either you or I.
I'm saying I'm 64.
Well, God love you.
I'm trying to remember 37. I'll say that Doncic, I'll give him credit for the other air. I'll give him a lot of credit. He plays with a little bit of swag, doesn't he?
Yeah. And it seems like it's hard to get under his skin. I think he relishes it.
Yeah.
And his play backs it up, too. You know, it was pretty impressive. Like you said, I've never seen anybody get completely washed like that. The Suns laid down. It was mystifying. Yeah. And it was kind of, you know, obviously boring, but at the same time, you kind of, your mouth was agape because you couldn't believe that they didn't have a run in them. It was just so one-sided from the get-go. It was disappointing.
Yeah, 64 wins in the regular season.
Well, that's the context that makes it disappointing, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You expected more of them.
I mean, they had 18 losses.
Yeah, no, and I saw them play it live. And I saw them play other nights when they were playing other opponents besides the Sixers, and they're really, really good because the game's played with the backcourt now, and they have two of the best backcourt players in the league, especially during the regular season. So that's what, you know, that's what they had going for themselves, but when you take that away, you start to see what a huge drop off it is when Chris Paul is having a hard time playing at his level.
Well, you're among the best in the business. I appreciate the time you gave us today and the perspective, Alaa. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Steve. Appreciate it. We'll see you next season.
And that is Sixers TV analyst Alaa Abdulnaby joining us a couple months ago when the Sixers season ended in the Eastern Conference semis to the Miami Heat. Coming up next, in the next half hour, Ray Diddinger, the now retired Hall of Famer. He came on the show in late May to promote his play that's coming to the Hershey Theater in August. Tommy and Me, It's a Wonderful Story, and we're going to hear about that coming up next in the next half hour here on a Tuesday best of edition of the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Back here on a best of the Steve Jones Show on this Tuesday. Matt Catrillo here with you all this week as Steve enjoys a well-deserved vacation. Steve always in the Sunbury Motor Studio. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf and online at sunburymotors.com. The now retired Hall of Famer Ray Diddinger joined us back in late May to promote his play that is coming to the Hershey Theater in mid-August, and I can't wait for that. I will be there for the Saturday show myself, taking my dad down, who's a fellow Eagles fan, so we're looking forward to seeing that. It's a play called Tommy and Me, based on Ray Diddinger's true story. He wrote this play on his relationship with former, the late Eagles receiver, Tommy McDonald, and Ray joined us back in late May to discuss the play.
It is great to have with us on the show one of the all-time greats in this profession or any profession, Ray Diddinger. Ray, welcome back. It's great to have you with us.
Thanks, Steve. It's always great to be back with you. How you doing?
Doing great. You know, the play Tommy and Me, obviously, it's going to be going to the Hershey Theater. I want to see in August. Is that when it's going to be? I think August 18th.
Yeah, we're going to do three performances, August 18th, 19th, and 20th. So, yeah, we're really looking forward to it. It's a story of me and Tommy McDonald and our lifelong relationship, which started. And the most exciting part about the whole thing is by bringing it to Hershey, we're actually bringing it back to where it all began. Because Hershey was where the Eagles had their training camp in the 1950s, and Hershey was where I first met Tommy when I was a 10-year-old kid with an autograph book, and Tommy was a rookie with the Eagles, and that was where we met. I asked for his autograph. He handed me his helmet, asked me to walk him to the practice field. That was how we met. And 1998, the two of us were standing together on the steps of the Pro Football Hall of Fame. It was quite a journey.
Yeah, it is an incredible journey. And to have it come to life in theaters and so forth, what is that like for you to have that story told?
It's beyond wonderful. It really is. I just always felt that it was a unique story. I don't know that there's anyone quite like it, that a little boy, a 10-year-old boy, looking up to his football hero, actually develops a relationship and a friendship with him over time. And then later on, when I became a sports writer, that I found myself in a position where I could kind of lead the charge to try and get Tommy into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And, you know, then when it finally happens in 1998, he turns around and says, "I want you to be my presenter." And we get to take that ride through the streets of Canton and stand on the steps of the Hall of Fame side by side. You know, the little 10-year-old kid from Hershey and the all-pro wide receiver reunited at the Pro Football Hall of Fame. It's a wonderful story, and I always wanted to write it. I always just thought it was a really nice, feel-good kind of story that people would enjoy. And I had never written a play before, but I thought, well, let me give it a try. If the story is so good that the story really just kind of tells itself. I mean, you don't have to be Eugene O'Neill to turn this into a good play. So we wrote it, we staged it, and Steve, this is going to be the seventh year that this play has run in various theaters all around the area. But I always hoped that one day we would bring it back to Hershey, and now we finally will.
In fact, I think Ross Tucker's going to be there one night. Ernie Accorsi, of course, Ernie has great connections up here at Penn State. He's going to be a part of it another night, which is really great. Is it fair to say this is not just a story about friendship, but about loyalty and a lifelong journey? Is that fair?
Yeah, that's totally fair. That's exactly what it is. I mean, people sometimes see the advertising and they see the pictures of Tommy, you know, in his Eagles uniform, where they know kind of who Tommy is, and they think it's a play about football, and it is to some degree, but I think it's really a much larger story, and it's really a story about relationships and dreams coming true, and I think that's the beauty of it, because every show ends with a Q&A. We end every performance by bringing the actors and the director and myself on the stage. And we field questions from the audience. And almost every performance, there's always somebody in the audience that says, you know, I wasn't all that excited about coming to this play because I'm not a football fan, I don't root for the Eagles, and I never even heard of Tommy McDonald. But I love this story. It's just such a beautiful story of this little boy and his hero and this life's journey that they took that I had tears in my eyes at the end. We hear that all the time. So, you know, that's kind of what I tell people. You know, you don't have to be, you know, I always stand in the back of the theater, Steve, and I see the people come through the door. And the people that come through and they're wearing, like, Eagles jerseys and the face paint, I don't worry about them. I got them already, okay? I mean, I'm not worried about whether they're going to enjoy this. I know they will. But it's the other people, you know, just the theater goers, the subscribers, the people that aren't football fans. When they come in and you see them drawn into the story, and at the end they're jumping up for the standing ovation and they've got tears in their eyes, you know, that's when you know as a storyteller you've really accomplished something. And that happens every night. And I know it's going to go double in Hershey because there's that connection there. I mean, so much of the story is built around Hershey and the town of Hershey and that era in the 1950s when pro football really did come to Hershey, Pennsylvania. That's a big part of the story, and I think people are really going to enjoy that.
Yeah, no question. Now, being a sports writer and breaking into the business, did you have people tell you, geez, Ray, I mean, you sure you want to do that? There aren't many jobs. Did you ever hear that along the way? Because then I'm going to link it to Tommy here at one point.
Oh, sure. Yeah, all the time. Yeah. I mean, I knew that's what I wanted to do. I mean, that was what I wanted to do really from the time I was in, like, 6th or 7th grade. I mean, I kind of said, that's what I want to be. That's what I want to do. But, you know, my dad, I mean, sat me down and tried to explain to me, you know, there aren't that many of those jobs. You know, and you know how many guys out there, how many people out there are thinking exactly what you're thinking, that that's what they want to do, too? You know how tough the competition's going to be? You know how remote the chances are? And I did, but I felt, you know, it didn't change my mind. I mean, this is what I wanted to do. I really felt that this was what I was meant to do. And so I was just going to go for it, you know, and if it didn't work, it didn't work. And then, okay, then I'll go sell cars or whatever. But, I really wanted to try this and try and make a go of it. You know, here we are, Steve. I mean, 53 years later, I'm still doing it. And the thing is, I love it just as much now as I did when I started.
Exactly. Now, here's the linkage to Tommy. Now, I'm saying this from a perspective. Now, I never saw Tommy McDonald play college. I wasn't born then. But I did see Tommy McDonald play with the Eagles.
Right.
Look, here's the bottom line. All right? You and I both know in the combine world today, too short, too small, whatever, a lot of twos put in front of him.
Oh, yeah.
Yet he's in the Hall of Fame. Have you ever thought about the parallels about a Ray? You know, there aren't many people that make it. This is hard to get into. Maybe you ought to do something else. And he probably heard the same thing.
Sure. I mean, it really is a story about beating the odds. And in that sense, we both did. You know, and I mean, you're talking about today's combine world, how everybody is measured by the tape measure and the stopwatch, and that's really true. But that was even true in the 50s. You know, I mean, people, you know, Tommy, when he came out of high school, he broke all the scoring records in New Mexico where he grew up, and most of the colleges all said, "Now you're too small." His mother wanted him to go to Notre Dame, and Frank Leahy said, "Now he's too small." So he went to Oklahoma and becomes an All-American on a team that didn't lose a game. He didn't lose a game his entire college career. He graduated Oklahoma. Yeah. He's 31-0. Then he comes to the NFL, and all the scouts look at him and say, "Now he's too small." You know, and so the Eagles grab him in the third round, and he comes in, and within 3 years, he's the best receiver in football and helps him win a world championship in 1960. And by the time he finished his pro career, he was sixth all-time in catches, he was fourth all-time in yardage, and he was second all-time in touchdowns. I mean, he was an all-time great player and overcame odds every step of the way.
That's okay. The guy I work with every Saturday for the past 25 years was just heard his name on radio, where a guy going after the Steelers job said he would have been a backup special teams guy. So,
I know. That's a very good example. I mean, as great a player as Jack was, and a great player all through his college career, I was covering the NFL in the early 70s, and I heard the scouts, and I loved them. I saw him play at Penn State, and I said, "This guy's a great player, and he's going to be a great pro. There's no question in my mind." And I tell the scout, nah, he's too small. Nah, he's too small. He can't play. But that's the beauty of the whole thing. I mean, that to me is I watch the NFL draft with a smile on my face every year, because every year you have the pundits and every year you have the experts and the draft nicks, and they have all the answers, right? They know every 40 time, they know every vertical jump, they have all the answers about who's going to make it and who's not. And in the end, they're wrong, just the same as the rest of us are wrong. As Seth Joyner has often said to me, and Seth Joyner, you know, eighth round draft pick, became a great player. Seth always says, there's no instrument that's been made yet that can measure the human heart. And that is so true. I mean, it borders on cliche, but it's absolutely true. I mean, you can measure the height, you can time them in the 40, you can do all of that stuff, but you can't look inside the guy. You don't find that out till you put him on the field and let him play. And the great ones, that's where they'll show themselves.
And there's also that, to be a lot of the great ones, quote, know how to play the game.
Mm-hmm.
Tommy was what, 5'9", 170, somewhere in that neighborhood?
5'9", yeah. They listed him at 5'11", 185, but he was actually 5'9", 170, and less than that at Oklahoma.
Right. Well, you have to know how to play. What were a couple of areas where you can tell us where Tommy McDonald, not just with athleticism, but with his brain, made plays?
Well, Norm Van Brocklin and Sonny Jurgensen, who were his two quarterbacks in Philadelphia, both over time said that that he had the best hands of any receiver they ever played with. Yeah. And I can say this as someone who saw every game he played as an Eagle. And this is I'm not this is no exaggeration, and this is not a figure of speech. I never saw him in his all his time with the Eagles ever drop a pass. I mean, zero. Never. Mm-hmm. Never happened. If the ball hit him in the hands, it was caught. Or as he used to say, that's leather in my pocket, was how he used to put it. He never dropped a pass. And the other thing that was that he ran great patterns. You know, and this was back in the 50s into the 60s, an era when defenders could pretty much do whatever they wanted to do to a receiver. I mean, you know, the idea, they talk about press coverage now. I mean, that's nothing compared to what it was like trying to get off the line of scrimmage in the 50s. I mean, you had defensive backs that were just beating guys up and literally throwing them on the ground, not letting them get off the line of scrimmage. And yet Tommy was so quick and so elusive and also so tough. I mean, pound for pound, a tremendously tough player, that he just fought right through it. And when other guys were afraid to go across the middle, and believe me, going across the middle in those days, you were really taking your life in your hands. That was his favorite pattern. I mean, that 15-yard dig, that quick slant across the middle, that was his favorite route, and nobody ran it better. And to this day, I'm not sure I've ever seen anybody run it better.
There was no, quote, 5-yard contact area back when Tommy played.
Oh, so. No, there was not. The one, I think the most memorable quote, that followed him throughout his career. And Tommy said this right up to the day he passed, was the greatest compliment he ever received, was the 1960 championship game. The Eagles beat the Green Bay Packers at Franklin Field, 17-13. It was the only postseason game Lombardi ever lost.
Right.
And after the game was over, Lombardi said to the reporters, and I found the quote in the paper, and I repeated it to Tommy, and he said, yeah, I know, it's the greatest compliment I ever received. Lombardi told the reporters, if I had 11 Tommy McDonalds, I'd win the championship every year, was what Lombardi said. And Tommy said, you could take all of my honors, all of my plaques, all of my trophies, all of that stuff, and you can have all of that. Just give me that quote. Just give me that quote, and that's enough. Coming from Lombardi, getting that kind of respect from a guy like Lombardi, Tommy always said was the highest honor he ever received.
It's interesting that sometimes people will meet a figure they consider to be larger than life. It doesn't always happen this way, but they'll walk away disappointed. Right. Now, some people you meet, they're larger than life, and they meet every expectation.
Sure.
Well, what was it about Tommy McDonald, where not only did you connect, but to you he's a larger-than-life figure that looked at you and made you feel like you were larger than life?
Yeah, true. The thing was, a couple minutes ago, you really put your finger on it when you talked about how small he was. Because even in that era of pro football, even in the 1950s, he was small. I mean, he'd be like super small today. But even in the 50s, he was small. He was just little. And I remember waiting outside the locker room in Hershey, waiting for him to come out to go to practice that day. And I was standing there waiting for his waiting to get his autograph. And the thing that struck me was when he came out the door. Now I'm a 10-year-old kid, right? I'm like a sixth grader.
Yeah.
I'm a 10-year-old kid standing there with my autograph book. I swear he didn't look any bigger than I did, and he didn't look any older than I did. I mean, he was so small, and he was so youthful-looking, with the short-cropped blonde hair and the baby face. I couldn't believe it. But I think that that's one of the reasons why not just me, but so many kids my age, so many little kids just identified with him. I mean, you knew there were great players. I mean, you knew Van Brocken was a great player. You knew Bednarik was a great player. I mean, there were great players on that team. But as a 10-year-old kid, it was hard to identify with them because they looked like grown men. You know, Tommy McDonald looked like you. Tommy McDonald looked like the guys you were playing with in the schoolyard. Mm-hmm. So every kid identified with Tommy McDonald because in our mind we were Tommy McDonald. The only thing that was different and the great advantage I had was I actually got to meet him. You know, my parents were such big fans that we actually drove to Hershey from Philadelphia and we actually went to the practices. And back then, you know, there were no ropes, there were no fences, there were no security guards. I mean, you could like stand right at the door and wait for your guy to come out. So that was where I met Tommy. And you know, and he just put his arm around me, handed me his helmet, put his arm around me and said, come on, let's take a walk. And that was how it all started. And, you know, in 1998, it wound up with both of us standing there at the Hall of Fame. Amazing story. And that's, you know, you asked me, how did it become a play? It was just that. It was just such a crazy, wild, wonderful story that I said, I have to write this. I have to share this with people because it's just too good. It's too good not to share.
It's not just another football story. It's a story that surrounds football. I think that's fair.
Mm-hmm.
And you do these Q&A sessions. What's the best question you ever had in the Q&A session about the play?
A lot of them, Steve, but one of the ones that's come up several times, and it's a really good question. The first time somebody asked me it, I thought, oh, that's really good. I wasn't prepared for that. I hadn't thought about that, but that's a good question. It was a young guy who had never seen Tommy play, but he had seen the play now, and now he was really intrigued, and he wanted to know more. And he said, just for my frame of reference, I've never seen, I don't remember football back then. I only see the game today. Who is Tommy McDonald? How would you compare Tommy? How would you express Tommy McDonald in contemporary terms? Who is he like? You know, who could I, in my mind's eye, trying to get a picture of this guy? Who would I envision? And what I said was, if you took Brian Dawkins' heart mm-hmm. and you put it in DeSean Jackson's body, yeah. you'd have Tommy McDonald. And that's really kind of what it was. I mean, you know, what DeSean Jackson brought to the Eagles and what he brought to the NFL in terms of that game-breaking mm-hmm. explosiveness. I mean, every time he touched the ball, he had a chance to score a touchdown, and was always making the big play at the big moment. That kind of talent, combined with the incredible, indomitable will that Brian Dawkins brought to the field, you put the two of those together, and you have a pretty good approximation of Tommy McDonald.
And while the Eagles and everybody else is in training camp, this will be in Hershey, August 18, 19, and 20.
Yeah, and you mentioned that we've got a different host each of the nights to handle the Q&A. So we got Ross Tucker the first night. We got Dennis Owens from the Harrisburg TV okay. anchor is going to do it yep. the second night. And on the final day, the Saturday afternoon matinee, Ernie Accorsi is going to do it. So it's going to be a great run, and it's such a thrill for me, and really the cast too. I mean, we've had all the same actors since we started, and for all of us to be bringing this back to Hershey, where we know it all started. In the theater is in the building that was actually the players' dormitory back in the 1950s. Yeah. I mean, to have all of this connect this summer is something I know we're all looking forward to.
In fact, it's right out there in that corner where you probably first met him, right?
Yep. It's all right there. And, you know, the beauty of it, and one of the things I feel best about, Steve, is the fact that Tommy lived to see it. You know, Tommy yeah. actually got to see the play. He came with his wife, the kids, the grandchildren, and they came to see the play. And, you know, we've had a lot of people come and see it, and a lot of people enjoy it, but nobody enjoyed it as much as he did. just seeing him in the audience and just seeing him laugh and point at the stage and say, yeah, that's it. I remember that. I mean, to see how much he enjoyed it was, to me, that's the best part of the whole experience. It has really been a wonderful, wonderful ride.
Absolute pleasure to spend any time with you. This is another great, I mean, I know this is 6-7 years, but it's just great you've been able to do this. So congratulations on its success.
Thank you, Steve. And when it rolls into Hershey, I hope you and Matt are able to get down there and catch a performance. I think you'd really like it.
I would love to. Thank you so much for the invitation. We appreciate that.
All right, Steve. You take care. Talk to you anytime.
And that is the retired Hall of Famer, Ray Diddinger, who joined us in late May, as Tommy and me come to the Hershey Theater in August. Certainly look forward to that. We'll continue our Philly sports theme show coming up next. To begin the final hour of the show, it'll be NBC Sports Philly's Michael Barkin. He joined us a couple weeks ago. We'll talk some Philly sports and more with him. And that's coming up as we continue here on a best of the Steve Jones Show here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.